For today is how to create big things on a small budget. So first of all, I have to hear who here played the game. Big chunk of people, okay. That's because I want to just show you a movie for the people who hasn't seen it. Which is 1 minute long, just to give you an idea of what the game is about. The game was originally created and directed by my partner, Jensen. It's a 2D physics-based platform puzzle. As you saw in the video, it's created and only black and white in an aesthetic it's a minimalistic design. Everything from the beginning was created with the purpose of making the game simple. From the controls, to the way you get into the game, from everything. The story. The realistic is one of the things, like one of my core goals of the game. And then, in the end, we had the challenging gameplay, which was something we think was missing in a lot of games out there. The game was released on Xbox Live Arcade, the 21st of July, as part of the Summer of the Game promotion. And it was quite a success. It was really cool to see so many people there and play the game. But it went worldwide, like really, really quickly. And also, like, so we see that our expectations, like, game for gamers, you know, you expect gamers to like it, but it was like mixed press from all over the world, and the press been shown in art exhibitions and so on, and that was impressive. We didn't count that when we started. So I'll tell you a little about me. I made my first program when I was 6 years old. I've always loved computers. I always loved to tear things apart. I always loved to it's true. I had like books from the library. I was doing code from them. My first experience was with a game called Mew, which was some kind of Texas instruments. I've been full time. I've been working part time and freelance before this, but I've been full time in IT since 2000. And in 2006, I co-founded Limbo with my partner Arnold. And actually, when I was thinking about this talk, I was researching myself to see where did my interest come from. And I actually linked a lot of old stuff. And I actually found this old wish list when I was 13 years old. And it actually says a lot about what I was thinking about at that point. Because as you can see, the first thing I wished was an Amiga. And then it was a PC. Then it was money. Then it was a Game Boy, a lot of Game Boy games. It was a Nintendo, a lot of Nintendo games. And out of the first versions, in the bottom it says turn, at the top it says TV, and it says color in English. Because this was a time where I wasn't sure that it was going to be a color TV we were getting. Then there's a homework book, which is only like serious thing in this, and there's Amiga, a lot of other games, the Defender of the Crown, and there's actually this beats a ground with 15 shots. I don't know what I was going to use that for. And the last thing is a diving club. So my interest has been from the computer game is really comes from a like commercial game. My partner I was talking about before, I have a picture of him. It's this guy actually. This is from a visit to Riders. You can imagine how the meeting went. So, not too serious stuff. All of this came from the idea. The idea of making this game. As I said, the idea came from my partner, who had been working on this maybe for 2 years, and he didn't know how to get this into something bigger. He made the drawings, he made the first concept video, and he didn't know how to take that further. So when we met, it was all about getting this together. And when you start, when you don't have anything other than idea, it is pretty hard. We knew from the beginning that we weren't going to compete with anyone else because we couldn't. We started with literally no money. I had 20,000 euro in savings, and Art had the same in debt. So literally, we had zero money. So the idea for Art was that he was tired of everything out in the business. He's seen a lot of games, and he didn't think that they did it well enough. He think that games talk down to people. He thought that it was too much of explosions and guns and everything was the same. So we created a vision. And actually, I'm lying if I told you that this was something we had begun with, because this is something we have found out in retrospect in this project. But it's also anyways. But one thing which was important for us at the time was our creative freedom. And a lot of our choices which we made was based on that we wanted to have the creative freedom. But doing something which is a reaction to the business, we cannot, go with a big publisher, we cannot go with another studio now. We really wanted to do something totally different than everyone else. So our creative freedom and having the right to choose what to do was really important for us. Then the next thing we wanted to do is make something original. We don't think it's interesting to do something which is done before. And in the beginning we didn't do it for that would burn us any money. But we didn't care because the final thing I had on my side for the mission is we wanted a dream job. We wanted a dream job for ourselves and we wanted a dream job for the people we employed. That was important for us. If we wanted money we could do something else, work in America, I don't know. But we did this because we had these visions. And the reason why we went so well together, Art and I, was that we had the same visions. The road we took to get this thing was, first of all, independence. We went independent. We didn't want money which tied us up too much. We wanted a modern approach to run a business. Before that was very, very important. We didn't want the old architecture of people where one is the boss and there's a few other really people on it. And in the end, we have a lot of administrators and producers who do nothing else than administer other people. So we wanted to have a company of only talents which run by themselves. It's really, really easy to run a company. We started two, and in the end we were 15. And I was actually managing it all the time, but it's because we always, you know, found people who just typecast us for the game. It wasn't that big of a deal, actually. And the last thing I have on that slide is iteration. And I wrote it three times. Iteration is important, and we iterate a lot, both on the game, but also on the process. We always look at how we're making the game. And see, but maybe we have meetings once a week, but we also ask ourselves, is this good? Is it, are we wasting time, or are we proceeding? So if that didn't work, we iterated and did something else, and a lot of time we was on it. When we iterate a lot, it seems really logical when I say it, but sometimes it's also really nice to have some set rules of yourself. You know, you meet every Monday, and meet this Tuesday. My first thing was, the next thing is the organic growth. This is something if you are going to start a project or have your own studio, you probably only experience once, unless you fire everybody there at the end. But it's something which is really nice to keep down the cost, because you hire people when they're really, really, really needed. You don't hire them before. You don't have like 50 people, which is going to make a game what they're going to do. You don't find find use for them afterwards. You actually have the need first. And that was something we were happy about, because we only hired people when we got a bit of money. And when we got a bit of money, we hired more people, and was like always growing the company slowly. And it's something I really recommend if anyone is starting a studio or wants to do a project. Starting with 5 people, 10 people from the beginning can be really hard, and if you need to pay them money, it's even harder. The opposite to organic growth for us, for I think many people, is the venture capital. And actually, venture capital is like this. It's a huge amount of money you get suddenly, and you really have to burn it really, really fast. But it's also money which comes with requirements. It's come with requirements to earn even more money. And you always feel like you stand under this rock, and you never know. You know this rock is going down, but you never know when. And we did raise venture capital, because at one point, you know, our mission exceeded what we could do with the money we got from government. What we learned from this is that it's something which is, I cannot say that it's not recommended, because sometimes you have to do it. So sometimes it's necessary to get your idea flying. But we would definitely, you know, think twice next time you take money from other people, because that's a really hard thing. The good thing about this was that when you do deals with the distributor, you have more leverage, because if you do deals with Sony, Microsoft, whoever's out there, and they pay you the money, or publisher, they pay you the money, they often control the projects. Maybe they say they won't, but they have the money, so they will not give you the next amount of money if you don't just do what they're saying. When you have the money yourself, you know, you have